Boldwood presents The Fiance, written by Rona Halsall and read by Stephanie Beattie. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Boldwood. Prologue. 2 years ago. The words scattered in Anna's mind like marbles dropped on a hard surface, bouncing and rolling, unable to form a sequence that made any sense. She frowned up at the doctor, a young woman, probably in her early 30s, the same age as herself. Her shiny dark hair was tied back in a low ponytail, wisps escaping around her face, framing concerned brown eyes. "No," Anna said, a frantic quiver to her voice. "That can't be right." She tucked her blonde hair behind her ears, once, then twice, then three times, a compulsive habit that appeared whenever she was stressed. And now she was more stressed than she'd ever been in her life. They were crammed into a small office, the only free space for a quiet talk, Anna hunched on a battered chair, coffee stains on the light blue seat. The doctor was sitting opposite her in a black office chair, gently swinging from side to side, like she was nervous, her hands gripping the stethoscope that draped round her neck. It was stuffy and hot, Anna's palms clammy as her hands clasped together in her lap, holding on tight, like they were scared of losing each other. "I'm so sorry," the doctor said, leaning forward and placing a comforting hand on Anna's shoulder, its warmth seeping through her t-shirt. She blinked, her body tensing. "This is real. It's happening." Her chest tightened, her breathing became shallow, and she started to feel a bit lightheaded. "Is there anyone who can come and get you? It's best not to be alone when you've had a shock like this, and you shouldn't be driving." Her words didn't register. Anna's mind still stuck on the first thing the doctor had said, unable to move past it. Dead. Her husband, Ollie, was dead. "I don't understand. It was a routine operation. That's what I was told. Very quick. How can he be..." It was impossible to say the word, let alone believe that it was true. Her lovely, goofy husband, who'd been teasing her about her current celebrity crush only 2 days ago. How was it possible that he was no longer alive? They'd been making plans to travel, buy their own house, start a family, the next 5 years all mapped out. And now she couldn't see beyond this moment, had no idea how to exist without him. She caught the doctor's eye, gave a feeble smile, her head shaking, her whole body shaking. I heard you wrong, didn't I? This is me catastrophizing." The doctor stared at her, lips pressed together. "I'm so sorry, Mrs. McKenzie, but I think you heard me right. And I know it's hard to take in, but your husband unfortunately passed away in theatre." The words lodged in Anna's heart, an emotional hammer blow forcing a sob from her throat, and once she'd started, the anguish poured out of her like water gushing from a broken dam, an unstoppable sadness convulsing her body, tearing at her chest. She covered her face with her hands, stupidly embarrassed to be falling apart in front of a stranger. "But how?" she asked when she could finally catch her breath, swiping at her tear-stained face with a bunch of tissues the doctor held out to her. "How can that have happened?" The doctor's gaze sank to the floor. "I'll let the surgeon come and explain it in more detail. He shouldn't be long." She gave Anna's shoulder a gentle rub. "Unfortunately, these things happen, I'm afraid. There's always a risk with surgery. As we explain before the patient gives their consent, nobody's fault." Anna's jaw tightened, a surge of anger forcing her sadness out of the way. "I don't understand how you can say that," Him needing the second operation in the first place was somebody's fault, wasn't it? The words forced themselves out, sharp and pointed, needing to find a target, a place to spear the blame. If the first operation had been done properly, he wouldn't have needed the second. She paused, swallowed, determined to say it. And he'd still be alive. The doctor shifted in her seat, then stood, her expression blank, like she'd packed away her empathy. Like I said, I'll get the surgeon to come and explain the details. She fidgeted with her stethoscope. I understand it's a terrible shock. Can I get you anything? How about a hot drink? Or can I call someone to come here and be with you? Anna shook her head, eyes staring ahead of her, not seeing anything but Ollie's face. Laughing. He was always laughing and making her laugh too. He wasn't one to worry. Never let life get him down and could see the bright side in any situation. Exactly the sort of person she needed by her side. She tucked her hair behind her ears again, hands shaking. She shivered, cold now. How would she manage without him? It wasn't fair. He didn't deserve to die. He wasn't expected to die. So why the hell was he dead? She closed her eyes, her body rocking backwards and forwards as her arms wound themselves round her chest, fingers clasping her ribs. A keening erupted from her throat, and there was nothing she could do to stop it. Her world was broken. She was broken. And someone needed to pay for what they'd done. Chapter 1. Now. Anna's heart skipped when she noticed a change in Theo Heaton's profile on Facebook. Single, it said. Yesterday it hadn't said anything about relationships, and it had been the same for the 2 years she'd been following him. As far as she was aware, he was married, even if he didn't like to mention it on his profile. Come to think of it, had she ever seen a picture of him with his wife? She couldn't recall anything. He didn't give much away on his posts, and now Anna thought about it. She didn't know much about him outside of his work life. She enlarged his new profile picture on the screen of her phone, studying the face she knew so well without ever having met the man. Silver hair, cut short and styled on top to give a little bit of height. Playful, it said to her. His hair would curl, she imagined, if he ever grew it longer. His chin was square and clean-shaven, his skin tanned and pretty much flawless. He was 52, but he looked at least 10 years younger. Piercing blue eyes with a navy blue ring round the edge. Dark eyebrows. A straight nose, a little on the large side, maybe, but on him it looked noble. In fact, that word summed up his image. Noble. Trustworthy. Although there was a hint of a smile, creating little grooves at the corners of his mouth that said he had a sense of fun. She studied his lips, wondering how they could look so gentle, given everything she knew about him. She checked out the background for clues, saw that he was at a marina, rows of boats moored on pontoons behind him. Was that Caernarfon Castle in the background? Yes, unmistakable really. Was one of the boats his? He clearly had money, you could tell by the places he frequented, the smart-looking people he hung out with, his annual skiing trips to America, holidays in the Caribbean, the way he dressed. The black coat he was wearing in the picture was a barber, if she wasn't mistaken. It looked good on him. But then he was one of those men who never looked shabby or scruffy, if his social media feed was anything to go by. He always glowed. You could tell he smelt fresh, just from the pictures. Clean, shiny, immaculate. She'd started following Theo on Facebook and Instagram about 4 months after Ollie's death. He seemed to use Facebook for work-related posts and Instagram for his out-of-work activities, so she always checked both. Before that time, she'd been in shock, names and faces all blurring together in her grief. But when her mind had cleared a little, she was able to understand that Theo Heaton was the surgeon who'd killed her soulmate. Whatever had gone wrong in that operating theatre was his responsibility, even if the internal inquiry had decided otherwise. So, she'd started following him on social media for no logical reason other than it made her feel like she was doing something. Even if there was no tangible outcome, it alleviated the overwhelming feeling of helplessness that swamped her on a daily basis. She would look at his pictures and project hate at him, hoping that somehow all her negative energy would start to interfere with his life. Obviously, she had no idea if it worked in any way, but it made her feel better for a little while. For someone she'd never met, she knew a lot about Theo Heaton in his capacity as a surgeon. She had an encyclopedic knowledge of his career as a doctor. In fact, she could recite his CV like it was her own. She knew where he'd worked in the past, had searched for other instances of his patients dying, looking for a pattern of negligence or incompetence, anything she could use to ruin his career. But she'd found nothing. She knew he ran a private surgical clinic, but no wrongdoings there either. It was annoying. But it did appear his carelessness with her husband had been out of character, just as his peers and bosses had said. Somehow that made it worse. Why did it have to be Ollie who died? In her frenzy to uncover professional wrongdoings, she hadn't thought to research his private life. It didn't occur to her it might be helpful. Never had she thought to scroll back through his social media feeds to the months before the operations. In fact, until today, when she'd found out he was single, her thinking had been very woolly. She'd looked at him and hated him for what he'd done. But outside of going through official channels, which had come to nothing, she'd no idea what she could do. Now, she could see an opportunity to learn more about the man himself, a way to get close to him. And that had to be her next move, because it was the only line of attack left. Could I date him? That would be the easiest way to find a weak spot, a way to hurt him. Everyone had things they didn't want made public, details she could use against him to tarnish his reputation, humiliate him, cause him financial harm. Information which, if it came to light, could destroy him in some way. Revenge is a dish best served cold, isn't that what they say? Well, 2 years was long enough for her rage to solidify into an ice-cold block in her heart. She had despaired at finding a way to make him pay for what he'd done, but now, an opportunity had been presented to her, and her gut instinct was to grab it with both hands. Her heart was going at a steady gallop now, excitement building in her chest. This was it, the chance she'd been waiting for. Is it really possible? She turned her phone camera on herself and gave a dissatisfied laugh when she saw the image. Tired and dull. That's how she looked. Dark shadows under hazel eyes tinged with sadness. Her mouth turned down. Unkempt eyebrows. Pallid skin. Hair looking limp and lifeless. She was not the sort of woman a man like Theo would be interested in. But then she hadn't bothered with her appearance since Ollie had died. Her hair needed a wash, and the lower half was purple, the ends split and frizzy. She'd had it cut and coloured the day before Ollie's funeral, wanting to look her best for him as she escorted his coffin to the crematorium. Just in case he was there, watching. Purple was his favourite colour. But it looked scruffy now. She ran her hands through the grown-out cut, her hair full of tangles. It was hard to remember when she'd last given it a brush, tending to gather it into a knot on top of her head to keep it out of the way. That was the danger of working from home. Nobody who mattered ever had to see the state you were in. And when she went out to the shops, she put on a baseball cap, It made her feel invisible, just how she liked to be. There were stains on her grey sweatshirt, where she'd spilt coffee and her fried egg sandwich had dripped. The collar was shapeless and fraying. She looked like a bag lady, someone without the facilities or the money to keep herself and her clothes clean. She sighed, turning the camera off, and studied his picture again as her mind wandered. Since Ollie's death, she'd become a recluse, always cancelling invitations to social gatherings at the last minute with what she hoped were plausible excuses, only agreeing to go in the first place to stop her friends fussing about her. Thinking about it, she wouldn't say she had any close friends now. Their knowledge of her was over 2 years old. The closeness a mirage created by social media and messaging. Most of them hadn't seen her in person since the funeral. The lives of her friends had moved on. Boyfriends becoming husbands. Babies arriving for a couple of them. Foreign travel. House moves. Career changes. New qualifications. Promotions. She'd watched it all happening without getting involved. An interested bystander. Her life had gone nowhere, pinned to the spot by her grief and her rage at the grinding unfairness of life. At 31, she was too young to be widowed, too young to have all her dreams ripped away from her. She blinked back the tears, so salty they made her eyes sting, wondering if she would ever move past this point. Could she accept that the baby she'd imagined in her arms, the one with Ollie's smile and his sticky-out ears, could only be alive in her imagination? Those trips to far-flung lands could only be lived in her fantasies. The chapters of her life would never have Ollie written in their pages. Sometimes it was too much to bear, and she would sit and howl until she was all cried out. But nobody knew that because she kept everyone at bay, even her parents. Her stock answer being, "I'm fine, everything's fine." But she wasn't. Ollie had been the sensible one, the practical half of their partnership. The one who stopped her from panicking when things went wrong, like the kitchen tap leaking or the washing machine breaking or the boiler refusing to come on. He grounded her. Made life an adventure she couldn't wait to experience. Without him, she existed in a dark tunnel, with only one direction of travel, and however many steps she took, she never got closer to the light. In fact, there were times when there was no light. She shook the dark thoughts out of her head before they started taking over. They were her constant companions, but she couldn't spend time with them now. She had things to do. Plans to make. Because Theo being single had opened up a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that she was determined to take. She'd get one shot at this, and she had to make it work. One chance to cleanse herself of the caustic rage that boiled inside her, corrosive and all-consuming. This was her chance to make things right, to balance the scales of justice a little. Perhaps then she would stop being plagued by the nightmares and the intrusive thoughts that brought her to tears at random moments. Perhaps then she could start living again instead of existing in this endless fug of sorrow and pain. Looking through her photo gallery, she scrolled back to when she'd been happy and found a picture Ollie had taken of her with a new range of scarves when she'd first opened her Etsy shop. Thank goodness she'd had a chance to get that established before she found herself on her own. In the picture, she was grinning, eyes sparkling, her hair short and shiny with a long fringe tucked behind one ear. She was wearing big dangly earrings that she'd made from silk offcuts and twisted into loops. That was a point in her life when she'd felt everything was starting to come together. They'd just had an offer accepted on a three-bedroomed property, where she could have a decent-sized workspace as well as there being room for a nursery when they were ready. Ollie had been promoted at the media firm he worked for, and she had big plans to develop her online business. That future had been taken away from her with Ollie's death. She'd pulled their offer for the house and stayed in their rented apartment, unable to decide what to do once he was gone. Most of the insurance money she'd received after his death had been invested in a long-term bond. It seemed like the safest option, to keep everything the same. Life had ground to a shuddering halt. She studied the picture of herself and let out a long sigh. Once she'd been attractive. She'd turned heads, she knew she had, and been so full of confidence she'd thought nothing could go wrong. Ha, how naive. Look what could happen in an instant. I could look like that again, she thought, a flurry of ideas blowing into her mind like autumn leaves hurried along by the wind. I could make men interested in me if I tried. Men like Theo. A smile curved her lips as she decided this was the best idea she'd had in a long time. Theo becoming single was exactly the chance she'd been waiting for, a challenge that would give her life focus. She gazed out of the window, planning a list of things she'd need to do. She would get her hair done first, and her nails, and her eyebrows, eyelashes as well, of course. Ditch the glasses and move back to contact lenses. She studied her face in her phone again. Maybe get her lips plumped a little. Glamorous was what she needed to aim for, because a man as well-groomed as Theo would want a woman who took the same care of herself as he did. And clothes. She'd need a whole new wardrobe of clothes. She laughed, excited now. There was some serious shopping to be done. Having studied him for the last 2 years, she knew his style, knew which brands he liked to wear, so that gave her some clues as to what she might need to get for herself. It's all possible, she told herself, the excitement mounting. Writing notes as she went along, she started a list of things she'd need to organise and buy for her makeover. An hour later, she sat back on the sofa, smiling to herself. This wasn't going to be cheap, but she'd left some of the insurance money in an instant access savings account for contingencies. If she thought of it as an investment into her future, an investment in her mental health and peace of mind, the cost was worth it. Yes, this might be the way to finally put everything behind her, exorcise the demons and move on. He's not going to know what's hit him, she murmured to herself as she started scrolling through the fashion sites, picking out items for her new look. She could almost hear Ollie laughing at her choices, and that spurred her on. The woman she was going to make herself into was not going to be the person he knew. And in an instant, the memories came flooding back. The night when her life changed. Chapter 2. Then. Ollie clinked his champagne glass against hers, grey eyes twinkling in the candlelight, his light brown hair tied in a man bun, his neatly trimmed beard a shade darker than his hair. They were sitting in their favourite Italian restaurant in a secluded corner booth, and it felt as though there was just the two of them in the world. "Here's to us," he said. "Happy anniversary, sweetheart. I can't believe it's been 3 years already, but it's been the best 3 years, hasn't it?" She beamed at him, more in love with this man than she'd ever been. He was everything she'd ever wanted, more than she'd ever hoped for, and every day she woke up stunned that this was her life. "To us," she repeated. "It's been wonderful. And I love being Mrs. Mackenzie." He took a sip of champagne and shook his head, grinning. "I'm such a lucky man." He took her hand, his thumb stroking her palm, sending tingles up her arm. "You know, I can't wait to see what our children look like." She laughed. "Steady on, Tiger. We've got dessert coming before we think about starting down that road. And a small matter of the house move to get through. I want to be settled in our new place with all the work done before we have any children. Otherwise, we'll be like my parents and end up living in a half-finished house forever." He grimaced, his hand slipping away from hers to rub his stomach, his eyes screwed up in pain. She frowned. Is that stomachache back again? He grunted, his face contorted. Christ, it feels like my guts are strangling themselves. Beads of sweat popped up on his brow, his face suddenly pale. He'd been having stomach cramps all day, and it had seemed to settle down before they came out, after he'd taken a couple of tablets for stomach acid. But now she could see from his face he was really suffering. This was different. Something had changed. He groaned and leant forwards, both hands on his stomach now, and she jumped to her feet, rushing to his side, not sure what she could do to help. It's getting worse, he said through gritted teeth, panic making her heart race. It was her job to look after him, her job to work out what to do, but she'd never felt so clueless in her life. Shall we just go home? She looked around for a member of staff wanting to ask for the bill. I'll get a cab. He groaned again, and she frantically waved her hand in the air, trying to attract someone's attention. Thankfully, a waitress spotted her and hurried off to sort out their bill once Anna had explained the problem. By the time she'd paid and organized a cab, Ollie was looking even worse. He said he was too hot and he was certainly sweating profusely, and when the cab arrived, he was struggling to walk, doubled over with the pain. There was only one place they were going, and it wasn't home. Can you take us to the hospital, please? She asked the cab driver, desperate to get medical help. Quick as you can. Fortunately, it was midweek. The hospital wasn't full of weekend drunks who'd started fights with each other, and the triage nurse recognized that Ollie was in significant pain. Anna felt unbearably helpless, and all she could do was hold his hand, tell him everything was going to be okay, while they waited to be called into the treatment room. It took longer than she would have liked, but the examination and tests gave appendicitis as the problem and surgery as the answer. By this time, it was the early hours of the morning, and she was so tired. Her eyes were dry and sore, hurting every time she blinked. She watched as he was wheeled off to surgery, telling him she loved him one last time before he disappeared through the double doors and down the corridor. All she could do was sit and wait, reminding herself it was a routine operation. Her husband was in good hands. It would be fine. Absolutely fine. What had started as the most wonderful romantic evening had turned into a frightening whirlwind of pain and blood tests and concerned doctors. It was terrifying to see the person she loved suffering, and the whole experience had left her feeling shocked, jittery, and thoroughly exhausted. Up until now, Anna would say she'd had a good life, brought up by loving parents, with a brother and sister she was still close to, enough money in the family budget for them all to go on annual holidays, a good group of friends at school, and new friends made on her fashion design course at university. She'd never had to deal with a medical emergency, never had to concern herself with the possibilities of death. It was uncharted territory, and she was scared witless, unable to sit still as she paced the floor, waiting for news. Can I get you a drink? A nurse said as she popped her head into the empty waiting room. It was almost 4 a.m. and everyone else had been and gone. She studied Anna's face, her head cocked to one side, a concerned look in her eye. I don't want you to worry, love. I know it's been a horrible shock for you, but the surgeon who's on tonight has done this op hundreds of times. She gave a reassuring smile. Honestly, there's nothing to worry about. She was back a few minutes later with tea in a paper cup, which Anna clasped to her chest, feeling cold and empty, although the cup was almost too hot to hold. You can head off home if you like, and we'll ring you when your husband's out of surgery. There's nothing much you can do here, and you won't be able to see him when he comes out because they'll take him straight to the ward. You'll probably have to wait until visiting tomorrow afternoon. Anna shook her head, certain she couldn't leave him, wanting to feel she was as close as she could be until she knew that he was okay, that he'd survived the operation and there really was nothing to worry about. 2 hours later, A hand gently shook her awake, and she opened her eyes to see the nurse again, smiling at her. I just got word that he's out of recovery, and they're ready to take him up to the ward. Her smile widened. I told you there was nothing to worry about. Anna was unable to answer, not sure whether she was about to laugh or cry, and she ended up doing both while the nurse sat beside her and rubbed her back. She was stiff and aching from sitting for so long on a hard plastic chair, but she heaved herself to her feet, ready to go home now that Ollie was safe. Looking back on it now, she wondered how life had managed to throw them such a curveball. But that's what happens, isn't it? You think you've got everything sussed, think you're winning. Then a storm blows in, and all the cards you've carefully constructed your life with come tumbling down. Chapter 3. Now. Anna already felt so much better than she had just 10 days ago when she'd first had the idea of trying to date Theo. She'd developed a new habit of swinging her head just to feel the movement of her silky hair brushing against her neck, sitting there, twisting it between her fingers while she got on with whatever task she was doing. Her eyebrows were tamed and shaped, and her facial had improved the tone of her skin. She was also drinking loads of water, and had done a weekly shop, buying a pile of vegetables and healthy ingredients. She'd even bought herself a cookbook. When Anna set her mind on a goal, it was full commitment, nothing less, and she was completely obsessed with making herself into a woman Theo would want to date. It had taken over her life, but it felt like a good thing, having something new to focus on. It had pulled her out of the bog of despair she'd been wallowing in, and she'd actually caught herself singing in the shower that morning, something she hadn't done in years. Obviously, this wasn't going to be a quick process. She knew transformations took a certain amount of time if they were to be convincing, but she was delighted with the results so far. Every bit of progress was a step in the right direction. She checked her watch and stood up from her work desk, stretching. It was amazing how having Project Theo to focus on had more than doubled her productivity. She eyed the pile of parcels, orders ready to post, and for the first time since Ollie's death, she felt a glow of satisfaction, a warm feeling of well-being about a job well done. It was nearly time for her appointment at the optician's to see about her contact lenses, an important part of her makeover. She used to wear them before she met Ollie, over 7 years ago now. But then she found she didn't want to be bothered with them anymore, and Ollie said she looked cute in glasses, so she'd stopped wearing the lenses. She was strangely excited to give them another try, convinced they'd be worth the investment. Ollie always said it was her eyes that had drawn him to her, large and round in her delicately boned face. If she was intent on snaring her man, it was only right to make the most of her best feature. The weight she'd lost since Ollie's death had accentuated her cheekbones and given her back the figure she'd had in her early 20s. She'd thought she was getting a bit skinny, but looking at the pictures she'd found of Theo's wife, she believed that was how he liked his women. And it meant she could go for outfits she wouldn't have considered when she was carrying more weight. It was exciting, dressing up in her new clothes, and she couldn't wait for more of her purchases to arrive. She checked herself in the long hall mirror, pleased with the grey skinny jeans and cream cashmere sweater she was wearing. Simple but elegant, and not a muffin top to be seen bulging over the top of her waistband. Every cloud has a silver lining, she thought, as she grabbed her keys and left the house, humming to herself as she walked into town for her appointment. In the past, she would have driven, although it was not that far. Now she tried to walk everywhere as part of her new fitness regime, getting muscles back on her spindly legs. She had other jobs to do while she was in town, not least checking out the gym where Theo worked out 3 times a week. He always posted gym pictures on a Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and had done all the time she'd been monitoring his social media, so there was no reason to think anything would have changed. Once she'd finished at the optician's, she made her way to the gym, housed in a redeveloped retail site that had once been an Aldi before it moved to bigger premises. The front was tinted glass, but she could see the shadows of people on the treadmills, felt a twitch of nerves before hitching her fake Dior bag over her shoulder and heading inside. The reception area was quite small but plush, with a curved reception desk straight ahead. The receptionist, a young woman in her early 20s with bleached blonde hair, looked up when she heard the door and gave her a toothy grin, her smile so white it was disconcerting. "Oh, hello," Anna gushed. "I just wanted to inquire about membership. Can I pay for ad hoc sessions or do I have to pay a subscription?" She gave a nervous laugh. "I've no idea how these things work." "It's completely up to you. Obviously, it's cheaper if you're a member, and then you can use the gym every day of the week if you like. But you can also pay as you go. Most people do that to get started. And when they settle into rhythm and know what classes they like, they switch up to a membership." Anna's hands clutched her bag, fighting the urge to run back out of the door. But if Theo was here regularly, then this was where she had to be. What better place to meet someone? She cleared her throat. "Okay, well, that sounds great." The receptionist grinned. "I can get you a tour if you like." Anna gave her a nervous smile. "Fantastic." She waited while the receptionist made a call, and a few minutes later, a young man wearing grey shorts and a white T-shirt came bouncing into reception, his hair slicked back in a style that could only work with copious amounts of hair product. He smelt wonderful, though, all zingy and fresh, his scent drawing her behind him as he showed her round. It was an impressive facility, with state-of-the-art equipment and a wide range of classes, ranging from classic weight training to yoga, CrossFit, spin classes, and Zumba. They also had a couple of treatment rooms where you could book a range of massages and an in-house physio who specialised in sports injuries. This was obviously serious stuff. Anna listened and nodded as they went round, taking a leaflet on all the available classes to study when she got home. She would sign up to a couple, she decided, then she could really familiarise herself with the place and make sure she was there at the right time to, accidentally, bump into Theo. Not yet, though. She wasn't quite ready. Her contact lenses would take a couple of weeks to come through, and she still had some beauty treatments to get booked in. Her next job was to check out the makeup counter at the chemist down the road. She'd had to empty her makeup bag in the bin, all of it dried up and unsuitable for the look she needed. She reckoned Theo was the sort of guy who liked smoky eyes, long lashes, something dramatic, whereas she favoured understated and neutral. It was going to take a bit of practice to get it just right. And that was going to be fun. She'd had a session with a makeup artist, and together they'd come up with the right look. She'd also been shown how to do it herself and had a list of products to buy. It would pay, in the long run, to have the professional help, because if you were going to do something, Anna's philosophy was to do it properly. No cutting corners, full commitment, nothing less. While her makeover was progressing, she was monitoring Theo's social media feed to see what he was up to, making sure he hadn't already snagged himself a girlfriend. That was the first thing she did when she got back home and frowned when she saw his latest post. A picture of a white room, no furniture, and a caption that simply said, "Starting over." Interesting. So he's moved out of the family home. It appeared he was no longer living in the boathouse on the edge of the Menai Straits, the stunning property where he and his wife had brought up their family. Anna had been down there a few times in the past, in the months after Ollie's death, hiding in the bushes at the side of the property with her binoculars. But she'd nearly been caught out once, and it had freaked her out so much she hadn't dared go near the place after that. Now, why would he have moved out? The boathouse hadn't been on the market. She knew this because she constantly checked new listings for that very eventuality. But if he and his wife had separated, which his single status suggested, The person who wanted the relationship to end was usually the one who left, which suggested it was him. Is he having an affair? Her heart sank. Maybe her plan to date him was doomed to failure before she'd even started. Perhaps he already had somebody else. Maybe he was moving in with them. She looked again at the photo of his new place, trying to see if she could work out where it might be. Oh, wait. She could see the vague outline of mountains in the distance. Ah, yes. She recognized that view. It must be somewhere up on that new estate in Bangor, by the hospital. Very nice. Some comments had started to appear on his post. People wishing him luck. She'd just have to keep checking his feed, see if anyone was blowing him kisses or leaving love hearts. A Google search led her to a list of local estate agents, and after 20 minutes checking rental properties in the area, she struck lucky. There was one house, let agreed, up on that estate. She gave a little fist pump. Now she knew where he lived, it was time to go and check it out, just to make sure he hadn't moved in with another woman. The last thing she needed was to be wasting her time. Because if this plan was a non-starter, she'd have to go back to the drawing board and work out another way to get to him. Excitement fizzed through her veins as she dug out her surveillance bag. Something she'd put together when she'd gone to spy on him at the boathouse over a year and a half ago. She had a pair of binoculars, a little notebook, snacks and a water bottle in there. Having it all together made her feel like she was doing something meaningful, worthwhile, moving towards an important goal. It had kept her going through the tough times. But now things were moving to a new phase. Victory was getting closer. She could sense it, and it lit a fire in her heart. Chapter 4. Then. She went to visit Ollie in hospital the day after his appendix operation, laden with a carrier bag of clothes, slippers, phone charger and toiletries, and another bag with books, puzzles and all sorts of bits and pieces that he might want and need. They hadn't given her any idea how long he might be in for, but she was hoping it would only be a couple of days, just to make sure he was healing properly. She hadn't spent a night without him by her side for such a long time. It had felt strange in the apartment on her own, like a piece of her was missing. For some reason, she felt nervous as she walked the corridors, having never been on a hospital ward before. She came from a healthy family and couldn't remember a time when any of them had needed to be an inpatient, which seemed to be unusual these days. Even her grandparents were all in rude health. Blessed by good genes, her parents used to tell her, and for that she was grateful. Hopefully this incident was a one-off, and they would soon be able to put it behind them, because the background smell of antiseptic was enough to make her stomach turn. The ward was busy with visitors, doctors and nurses all bustling about, the hum of conversations filling the air. She looked around while she waited at the central reception desk, peering into the four bays that seemed to make up the ward, each filled with a handful of beds. But none of the faces she could see were her husband's. She'd just have to wait until someone was free at the reception desk to ask where he might be. Finally, the nurse finished her conversation and put down the phone, glancing up at Anna. "Can I help you?" Her round face creased into a warm smile. Anna explained she was looking for her husband, and the nurse consulted her screen. Then her face changed, her eyebrows pinching together. "I'm just going to have to ask what's happening," she said, getting up from the desk as she looked around for someone to consult. Anna stood there, gripping the handles of the bulging carrier bags a little tighter, a feeling of unease building in her chest. She hadn't liked the change in expression on the nurse's face. She'd looked surprised, but not in a good way. Surely it should be easy to tell her which bed he was in. A few minutes later, the nurse came back, followed by a doctor, a small Asian lady with a long, dark plait falling down her back, her hair flecked with strands of grey, the obligatory stethoscope hung around her neck. She gave Anna a quick smile. "Hello, I'm Dr. Chandra. There's been a development with your husband." Her eyes swung round the reception area, still busy with visitors waiting to ask about their loved ones. Let's go into the meeting room where it's a bit quieter and I can tell you what's happening. A development? What sort of development? Anna's heart started to race, a sudden heat flushing through her body. She followed the doctor down the corridor into a small room near the entrance to the ward, fitted out with a low table and six comfy chairs. The doctor pulled out a chair, indicating the one opposite. Please, have a seat. Anna sat, putting her bags down by her side, her hands smoothing the legs of her jeans, before going into the tucking hair behind her ears routine. The doctor gave her a sympathetic smile. So, we were monitoring your husband and we noticed something wasn't quite right. He was experiencing some discomfort after he came round, so we sent him down for a scan just to check the operation site, and we discovered a problem. She looked uncomfortable, hesitated. Anna's mind raced through a terrible scenario that she really didn't want in her head, and she found herself blinking, trying to rid her mind of the horrible images. Is he okay? The doctor moistened her lips and finally spoke. It seems a swab was left at the operation site. Anna's eyes widened, her hand flying to her mouth. A swab? Left inside him? The doctor looked down at her hands as she mumbled. We think there might be a piece of medical equipment as well. Oh my God! Anna's brain felt like it had been jump-started, working so fast it was hard to keep up with her thoughts. And what does that mean in terms of my husband's health? I need you to be more specific. She wanted to leap out of her chair and shake the woman, see if that would make the words spill out of her mouth, words that would give Anna reassurance everything was okay. What's happening? She glared at the doctor, feeling her temper coming to the boil, her body tense. She looked away, telling herself it wasn't the doctor's fault. She was merely the messenger, and getting angry wasn't going to help. But this news was shocking. No, it was worse than that. It was appalling. She took a deep breath, trying desperately to calm herself down. The doctor was obviously flustered, her hands holding her stethoscope like it was a buoyancy aid, keeping her afloat in choppy waters. It was clear from her body language that she was finding this an uncomfortable conversation. He needed an immediate operation to remove the foreign objects and clean the site. He was happy to give his consent, and he's down in surgery now. We knew you were coming in to visit, and the consultant thought it would be better to tell you in person what was happening rather than give you a call. Another operation? Anna completely lost her cool, bouncing to her feet to relieve some of the nervous energy trapped inside her body. She walked in a circle, her hand clasped to her forehead where a headache had started to throb. How on earth did this happen? I thought you had to count everything these days and get things double-checked. I'm sure I saw a documentary about this not long ago. The doctor sighed, shook her head. I can only offer our apologies. I really can't comment on how it happened. I wasn't there, but I'm sure it'll be looked into. All I can say is it can be pretty hectic in theatre when it's an emergency operation, and we have been very short-staffed for the last couple of weeks with the new wave of COVID that's going around. Anna blew out a long breath, not sure what to think, but certain this was all wrong. It shouldn't be happening. A sudden thought made her heart stutter and she stopped her pacing, locked eyes with the doctor. He'll be okay, though. The doctor smiled and nodded. Please don't worry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.